When the institutions that would become CPMC and Sutter Health were established in the 1800s, average life expectancy was around 43 years, compared to today's average of about 79. Wooden ships sailed San Francisco Bay, homes were lit by gaslight, and messages were sent by telegraph. If the rugged, individualistic physicians who founded this medical organization in a wild town at the farthest edge of America were able to visit today, they might not recognize the buildings nor the way we currently practice medicine, but they would recognize the commitment to medical excellence in care of the individual.
This operation is taking place now as you see it. We are in the surgery amphitheater at Stanford University Hospital in San Francisco. Operating within the human heart is complicated, difficult, and dangerous. Until very recently, it was thought to be impossible.
Early in 1984, PPMC's first cardiac transplant occurred when Dr. Donald Hill implanted a new heart into Jane Falconer of Lower Lake, California. Eight more heart recipients returned to their homes after undergoing heart transplant procedures in that year.
We also had the unique experience of a pretty deep knowledge of assist devices based on Don's interest in the Thoratec PVAD, the paracorporeal VADs. And that confluence resulted in the very first year of our doing heart transplants here, doing the first successful bridge to transplant that had been done in the country. That was done in 1984, the first year of our transplant experience. And we published that experience 2 years later in the New England Journal of Medicine as the first successful bridge to transplant.
Then, in August of 2019, CPMC celebrates a major milestone when 29-year-old Mitch Peterson from Oakland becomes the 500th heart transplant recipient. The surgery goes extremely well. And only 11 days later, Mitch Peterson is discharged from the hospital to continue recovering and return to the active lifestyle he once enjoyed.
Heart transplantation is the triumph of science over disease, if there ever was one. Having 500 transplants at a single center is extraordinary in itself, and to be part of the team that is part of the 500th transplant, it's an extraordinary event.
The Bunky Clinic is world-renowned for many firsts, as described by Harry Bunky, the father of microsurgery, in this video clip from 1999.
In the early 1970s, we did the first toe-to-hand transplant here in the United States, and that was followed by the first scalp replant in the United States. And then we were first to really pioneer the use of various muscles for facial animation, and recently, we had the first tongue replant in the, as far as we know, in the world.
The reason that my father was is really considered the father of microsurgery is not only did he keep promoting it, keep training it, but he really got right down to the basics of trying to figure out how to do it at the very elemental level.
In 1987, PPMC considers starting its own liver transplant program. Liver transplantations were being done in a few places in the country, but still not in San Francisco.
How did the liver transplant program get started? Barry Levin, who was working in the kidney transplant program at CPMC, it was soon after he had come to PPMC, came to my office, I was chief of gastroenterology, and asked if I would support a liver transplant program at PPMC. The costs were not well known, the risks to the organization were not well known, and the clinical aspects were not well known. I became convinced there was sufficient knowledge that it was worthwhile for us to do it and for us to create new knowledge and try to answer some of the questions that then weren't answered. And Barry, it was exactly down that line.
PPMC sets its sights on recruiting Dr. Carlos Esquivel, who trained under surgical pioneer Dr. Thomas Starzl to lead the new liver transplant surgery program.
In the mid-90s, the CEO made a decision and an announcement that the direction for CPMC going forward in the future was going to be a primary and secondary managed care organization. I don't think he meant it entirely that way. I think he meant it there would be some tertiary and quaternary care. So the team that was doing so extremely well with Carlos Esquivel, the transplant surgeon, who was a uniquely capable and nice person, moved down to Stanford. And we were left with almost nothing. It turned out that they had at UCSF just the right person for us. When all of us met Bob, we thought, we're not really taking a risk. This person can do it. Our job was to stay out of his way, give him the resources, and just step back. And we could anticipate success that everyone would be proud of, particularly the patients.
CPMC's commitment to research in the field of liver disease and transplantation is underlined by the Ibrahim ElHefney Liver Biorepository, one of the largest liver biorepositories in the world. Thousands of biological specimens and information about these specimens are available for study to support ongoing and future research.
We now have thousands of patients who have participated in this biorepository and have longitudinal samples collected, and a number of important papers and some very interesting discoveries. And so when we go to say, you know, let's look for our 50 patients with some unusual form of autoimmune liver disease, and then we can say, well, we don't really understand what causes that form of autoimmune liver disease, but if we pull up those samples, we may be able to look and see some of the clues. This biorepository is one of the leading biorepositories in the world in liver disease.
Pancreas transplantation started at California Pacific Medical Center in 1984 when Dr. Sampson performed the first such procedure here. Once Dr. Esquivel was here and I had joined the practice, we resurrected the transplant program for pancreas, and our first one was in December of 1989. We are one of the largest pancreas transplant programs west of the Mississippi.
In the mid-2000s, nationally and internationally, because waiting lists were getting longer and longer, different countries and different transplant programs in this country started looking at different options. One of our patients, a gentleman named David Jacobs, that we transplanted by living donation and was heavily embedded in the software communities, came into my office and said, how can I help? How can we work together to improve access to living donor transplant? It was perfect timing. So David Jacobs then really went to his own workshop and started developing software, which ultimately became the software that we use today in our really large and nationally acclaimed kidney pair donation program. In expanding living kidney donation with our SWAP program, we became the largest program really west of the Mississippi to do multiple transplants on the same day. Barry Levin built this program with Jeff Collins and a couple of others with their own two hands. Barry was an expert in all aspects of kidney transplant, and so to be able to go down the hallway two doors and ask a world expert a question about a difficult patient was really just a huge benefit working at CPMC.
And certainly one of the things I'm proudest of as the CEO here is the incredible record we have in the transplant program, both in kidney and especially more recently in the liver program, of having way better than expected survival rates, the best in the country many years running. We can prove it. You can look it up. You can go on the national website of the SRTR, the scientific registry, and read about how well we do.
When I first started my career, when I talked to patients, they would talk about just worried about, you know, are they going to die? Are they going to retire at 65? Are they going to be able to enjoy this deferred gratification to retirement? Now my patients come in and they're just worried, are they going to have enough money they save? Because they're all living deep into their 90s, right? So the entire society's changed with innovations like transplantation, new technologies. We're living a lot longer. So we're now talking about, you know, quality of life and how long. So it's a good problem to have.
It If the rugged, individualistic physicians who founded this medical organization were able to visit today, they may not recognize the buildings, the technology, or the ways of current medical practice, but they would recognize the men and women who hold to the same fundamental commitment they held to: medical excellence in care of the individual patient. It's in our DNA.